Simon & Schuster Audio presents The Christmas Box by Richard Paul Evans. Read by Richard Thomas.
It may be that I'm growing old in this world, and have used up more than my share of allotted words and eager audiences. Or maybe I'm just growing weary of a skeptical age that pokes and prods at my story, much the same as a middle school biology student pokes and prods through an anesthetized frog to determine what makes it live, leaving the poor creature dead in the end. Whatever the reason, I find that with each passing Christmas, the story of the Christmas box is told less and needed more. So I record it now for all future generations to accept or dismiss as seems them good. As for me, I believe, and it is, after all, my story. My romantic friends, those who believe in Santa Claus in particular, have speculated that the ornamented brown Christmas box was fashioned by Saint Nick himself from the trunk of the very first Christmas tree, brought in from the cold December snows so many seasons ago. Others believe that it was skillfully carved and polished from the hard and splintered wood from whose rough surface the Lord of Christmas had demonstrated the ultimate love for mankind. My wife, Carrie, maintains that the magic of the box had nothing to do with its physical elements, but all to do with the contents that were hidden within its brass, holly-shaped hinges and silver clasps. Whatever the truth about the origin of the box's magic, it is the emptiness of the box that I will treasure most, and the memory of the Christmas season when the Christmas box found me. I was born and raised in the shadow of the snow-clad Wasatch Range on the east bench of the Salt Lake Valley. Just 2 months before my 14th birthday, my father lost his job, and with promise of employment, we sold our home and migrated to the warmer and more prosperous climate of Southern California. There, with great disappointment, I came to expect a green Christmas almost as religiously as the local retailers. With the exception of one fleeting moment of glory as the lead in the school musical, my teenage years were uneventful and significant only to myself. Upon graduation from high school, I enrolled in college to learn the ways of business, and in the process, learned the ways of life. Met, married a fully matriculated brown-eyed design student named Carrie, who not 15 months from the ceremony gave birth to a 7-pound, 2-ounce daughter whom we named Jenna. Neither Carrie nor I ever cared much for the crowds of the big city. So, when a few weeks before graduation we were informed of a business opportunity in my hometown, we jumped at the chance to return to the thin air and white winters of home. We had expended all but a small portion of our savings in the new venture, and as the new business's initial returns, albeit promising, were far from abundant, we learned the ways of thrift and frugality. In matters financial, Carrie became an expert at making much from little, so we rarely felt the extent of our deprivation, except in the realm of lodging. The three of us needed more space than our cramped one-bedroom apartment afforded. The baby's crib, which economics necessitated the use of in spite of the fact that our baby was now nearly 4, barely fit in our bedroom, leaving less than an inch between it and our bed, which was already pushed up tightly against the far wall. The kitchen was no better, cluttered with Jenna's toy box, Carrie's sewing hutch, and stacked cardboard boxes containing cases of canned foods. We joked that Carrie could make clothing and dinner at the same time without ever leaving her seat. The topic of overcrowding had reached fever pitch in our household just 7 weeks before Christmas, and such was the frenzied state of our minds when the tale of the Christmas box really began. At the breakfast table, in our little apartment, over eggs over easy, toast, and orange juice. "Look at this," Carrie said, handing me the classifieds. Elderly lady with large avenues home seeks live-in couple for meal preparation, light housekeeping, and yard care. Private quarters, holidays off, children, infants, welcome. 445-3989, Mrs. Parkin. I looked up from the paper. What do you think? She asked. It's in the avenue, so it has to be large. It's close to the shop, and it really wouldn't be that much extra trouble for me. What's one extra person to cook and wash for? She asked rhetorically. She reached over and took a bite of my toast. You're usually gone in the evenings anyhow. I leaned back in contemplation. It sounds all right, I said cautiously. Of course, you never know what you might be getting into. My brother Mark lived in this old man's basement apartment. He used to wake Mark up in the middle of the night, screaming at a wife who'd been dead for nearly 20 years. Scared Mark to death. In the end, he practically fled the place. A look of disbelief spread across Carrie's face. Well, it does say private quarters, I conceded. Anyway, with winter coming on, our heating bill is going to go through the roof in this drafty place, and I don't know where the extra money will come from. This way we might actually put some money aside, Carrie reasoned. It was pointless to argue with such logic. Not that I cared to. I, like Carrie, would gladly welcome any change that would afford us relief from the cramped and cold quarters where we were presently residing. A few moments later, Carrie called to see if the apartment was still vacant, and upon learning that it was, set up an appointment to meet with the owner that evening. I managed to leave work early, and following the directions given to Carrie by a man at the house, we made our way through the gaily lit downtown business district and to the tree-lined streets leading up the foothills of the avenues. The Parkin home was a resplendent, red-block Victorian mansion with ornate cream and raspberry wood trim and dark green shingles. On the west side of the home, a rounded bay window supported a second-story veranda balcony that overlooked the front yard. The balcony, like the main-floor porch, ran the length of the exterior, upheld by large, ornately lathed beams and gold-leafed wainings. The wood was freshly painted and well-kept. A sturdy brick chimney rose from the center of the home amid wood and wrought-iron spires that shot up decorously. Intricate latticework gingerbreaded the base of the house, hidden interspersedly by neatly trimmed evergreen shrubs. A cobblestone driveway wound up the front of the home, encircling a black marble fountain that lay iced over and surrounded by a snow-covered retaining wall. I parked the car near the front steps, and we climbed the porch to the home's double-door entryway. The doors were beautifully carved and inlaid with panes of intricate floral patterns etched in glass. I rang the bell, and a man answered. "Hello, you must be the Evanses." "We are," I confirmed. "Marianne is expecting you. Please come in." We passed in through the entry, then through a second set of doors of equal magnificence, leading into the home's marbled foyer. I have found that old homes usually have an olfactory presence to them, and though not often pleasant, unmistakably distinct. This home was no exception, though the scent was a tolerably pleasant combination of cinnamon and kerosene. We walked down a wide corridor with frosted walls. Kerosene sconces, now wired for electric lights, dotted the walls and cast dramatic lighting the length of the hall. "Marianne is in the back parlor," the man said. The parlor lay at the end of the corridor, entered in through an elaborate cherry-wood door casing. As we entered the room, an attractive, silver-haired woman greeted us from behind a round, marble-topped rosewood table. Her attire mimicked the elaborate rococo decor that surrounded her. "Hello," she said cordially. "I am Marianne Parkin. I'm happy that you have come. Please have a seat." We sat around the table, our attention drawn to the beauty and wealth of the room. "Would you care for some peppermint tea?" she offered. In front of her sat an embossed, silver-plated tea service.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.